I can't believe that I was proud of this at one point. You're not going to spend 44 hours on your art file. You'll get a detailed breakdown, time-saving tips, as well as step-by-step process to help you make your first model. First, let's understand how separating art translates into moving model. One of the first things that confused me were terminologies like VTS, Live2D, transformation, mesh, so I'll break it down in simpler terms. For a VTuber model, the first step is having a design. Once you have the design of your VTuber model, you have to spend time separating the art files. The reason why we separate art is to mimic the 3D look with 2D means. Once that's done in your program of choice, that gets exported into Live2D. Live2D is the program used for riggers to essentially add movements and telling where the separate art to go and how to function. And finally, the file from there gets uploaded into VTube Studio, where all the information for the art and the rigging gets translated into facial tracking. Before you start, make sure you have the proper art program to do the art separation. The only criteria the art program needs is to be able to export PSD or Photoshop files. For this video, I'll be using Clip Studio Paint, but the steps can be followed in any art program really. Some artists are able to use mobile apps to make their VTuber. You might be limited by your layer file management, considering more complex models will have more layers attached to it. Next, you want to open a new canvas. The width has to be 3000 to 4000 pixels, and the height has to be 6000 to 8000 pixels. You can always shrink your file size, but you can never scale it up. You may have noticed that I selected this VTuber template here. I have Neko Gayeta's VTuber template, which sets up the canvas with preset folders and layers. I'll talk about this a little bit more a little later. Next, you want to open up symmetry. In CSP, press view, grid, and then view, grid, ruler bar setting, and change the gap to 1000 pixels. Click on the symmetrical ruler and line up the ruler to the middle. To turn off the symmetry ruler, you can press this button here in CSP. It's easier and faster for beginners to make symmetrical models for their first one. Now we're gonna write R and L on the canvas like this. When referring to the left or right of the model, it's referred by its anatomical position, meaning it's not our left and right, but the model's left and right. Now we'll make the basic folders and arrangements shown on screen. You can pause to make this, or you can download Neko Gayeta's template in the CSP store. Right now, the organization is pretty basic, but as the video goes on, you'll have your own set of layers, and you're more than capable of knowing where it goes. For future layer names, there's a rule that you have to follow. Number 1, names should be descriptive and avoid duplicates. Number 2, no spaces. Underscore is okay though. Number 3, you must include left or right orientation, and make sure it's the model's orientation as well. Now about art separation itself, people wonder whether it's better to separate along the way or to separate a finished drawing. Personally, I think it's way more beneficial to separate along the way. One of the pros of separating along the way is that it's easier to find and fill out the void spaces. Void spaces are going to be these areas with gaps and holes that should be covered despite not being seen at certain angles. As for the rules of separation, you're probably wondering, oh, where do I need to separate? We're going to have unique files between the both of us. Number 1, line art and render bases generally go together. This is not an illustration which has a sketch, line art, and color stage. You have to put them together. Number 2, the most amount of movements are going to be in eyes, hair, and mouth. Because these have the most amount of movement, they'll have the most amount of separation. Number 3, the areas you separate are as follows. Different body parts, connection points, clothes and their parts, accessories, things with varying depth. For example, this hoodie is separated into an upper half and lower half. The reason is because the hair itself is creating a depth that pushes the hoodie into the background, whereas the top is more in the foreground. Another example is shirt color here. There's an area in the front and an area in the back. And for the last example, this purse is separated like this because the difference is in the depth from the side and the front view. Rule number 4, you must draw the shadow continuously to avoid gaps in your shadow, as shown here by Faf. Number 5. Live2D only supports two blending layer modes, multiply and additive, or also known as add. Number 6, you need to draw the back of objects even if it's not visible. And lastly, number 7, if I don't mention it in this video, it's better to over separate than to under separate. First, we're gonna start with the head. You wanna separate the face and line art. Yeah, I did say that you should always have line art and render color together. but this is the only time where line art and render color are separated. The reason is because when the model turns its head, the line art disappears to give the 3/4 view a natural effect. To achieve this, you'll have what's called a mask. The mask is this green layer that will be invisible in the final product. It also makes other things invisible too, which is why we'll use it on top of line art. Lastly, don't forget the blush. Set the blush aside in the head file for now, but later on it's better to have a separate folder for expressions at the very top. I'll explain expressions a little bit more again. Next, we have the eyes. I will show the bare minimum for eye separation. If you want, you can do more separation, but I don't really go into the effects as much for my models. Make sure to include the upper eye, lower eye, the iris, the whites, different eyelashes, and even the eye shine. The eye shine is added with the add layer mode, which is shown here. Moving on to the nose. Nose are pretty simple. I just use a dot and then a dash of shadow on top of it. You can get more complicated with the nose because this is where people will use it to do a 90 degree turn. But in my opinion, as a beginner, it's better to have a nice 3/4 turn than uncanny 90 degree head turn. Next, we have the ears. The ears aren't anything special. You can just make them in this own left and right ear layer and make sure that it extends beyond the jawline or face. That makes it so that when you turn, you won't show any weird gaps or cut off. The mouth is the next detail of breakdown. I like to start with the open mouth and then have stuff like the tongue and teeth added in. Make sure that the upper and lower teeth is its own separate layer, and also have the molar its own separate layer if you really wanted to. After you have the mouth done with the teeth and everything, you can cover it up with the upper lip and lower lip. The easiest lip shape to work with is honestly a straight line, but some people really like working with curves and maybe a little bit of flare like I have here. Final thing for the mouth before you move on is to sketch the mouth shapes for A, E, U, A, O. The reason why we have this mouth shape sketch is because you will be making these mouth shapes during the rigging process, and it's better to have a guide rather than doing it blindly. Your model should already have a distinct front bang, side bang, and back hair separated. For the top of the hair strands, you want to make sure it blurs out the edges to seamlessly blend with the back of the scalp. You can make as many or as little strands, but consider that you might accidentally strain your PC this way. Even though VTuber is someone who makes her bangs one large chunk, it still looks pretty good in my opinion. After you have some of your bangs drawn, you will have a separate layer called the bald cap. The reason you have a bald cap is because you want to avoid having large gaps that show too much of the forehead on the model. Another unique aspect to separating the hair is having a separate scalp layer. This scalp layer will have the hair part on it, and so it will only be rendered at the very, very top. This might be a little bit confusing, but a way to check if your scalp layer is correct is by selecting the entire face and hair and moving it down just to kind of give a rough look of what it looks like. I'll draw in the accessories here, and finally I'll wrap it up with a head rotation sketch. This is similar to the mouth shape sketch in that this will help more of the rigors process than your own process. I suggest having a left, right, up and down look to it. You can also copy and paste the entire head right now and use that as a reference. Now, the final step is gonna be a little bit weird, but bear with me on this one. Hair shadow on the face is kind of funky. When you take the individual strands and make separate shadows for each one, it causes this weird overlap when you multiply the hair strands together. To solve this, you put a shadow base layer, which is this big rectangle. But in Live2D, you can clip all the hair layers to that shadow base, turn down the opacity on each hair strand, and that will create the seamless shadow shown here. Moving down, we have the neck. The neck is going to be funny because you don't want this to stop at the face line. Instead, you want to keep drawing this neck up into the eyes. If you stop the neck at the chin line or the face, gaps will show up when you make your head turn to the left or right. Of course, here's where you want to separate the hard shadow and make sure to extend the shadow beyond the neck itself as well. Below the neck, we have the torso. Torso is pretty simple, think of it like a t-shirt. If you have booba, make it a separate layer on itself. This is where we incorporate the depth rule, where things with different depth has to be on a separate layer. Originally, I didn't plan to have the jacket, be removable, so the upper arm was drawn like this. Later on, you'll see that I decided to change my mind and make the full arm instead. For a jacket puff, I separated into four parts. The left front, right front, back left, back right. As usual, we're applying the differences in depth rule here. Next, I'll draw the sleeves and its own accessories. I actually separate the sleeve cuff here. This is optional, but for me, I was thinking that I wanted the sleeves to move, but not the cuff to move when the rigging is done. Afterwards, I worked on the whole arm. You want to separate the upper arm, lower arm, and the hand, basically where the joints are located at. When you separate the upper arm and lower arm, make sure to pay attention to the elbow so that it seamlessly blends into one another. Moving down, I have a skirt for my character, but because I have a skirt, it requires a little bit more care and layering. The skirt in my model actually has three layers. The white front layer, and the pink front layer, and then one back layer. If I ever add rigging to the skirt, I can move around and also have the back part of it show through if needed. After finishing the skirt, I'll draw the upper leg and lower leg. Pay close attention to knees and make sure to blend it seamlessly so it's similar to that of the elbow. For the shoes, a little bit hard to break down, mainly because I have a very unique kind of shoe for this character. Knowing the rules for depth and different accessories, you will do just fine here. Finally, I'll add a skirt shadow at the leg. Make sure to extend the shadow here so that you have a continuous shadow moving throughout. Don't worry about the shadow spilling out and not being attached to the legs. This will all be fixed in Live2D because the layering management there is a lot more flexible. Objects don't have to be close to each other to be applied to each other as well. If you have a tail, draw it straight up and down. Even if it's a fluffy wolf tail, make sure it's drawn straight up and down because it makes it much easier to rig. If you want to create emotes for your VTuber model, create separate assets. You don't need to draw anything for the eyes or mouth shape because those are done within the rigging. I put the expression folder at the very top. Don't worry about how messy it looks. When your model is finished, go back and check the individual layers to make sure there's no dust or stray marks. You can also turn on border mode in your art program to see the dust more clearly. She looks great. I learned a lot from my first model, and now moving on to her, she looks just as good, if not better, with her art separation too. If you're interested in interacting with the parts separating this model, I have this model included as a PSD clip file and Ko-fi link down below. Feel free to support me by subscribing to my channel or checking out my live stream here on YouTube. Your support means a lot.